We're pastors and pastoral workers. We're counselors as Christians. So we want to know particularly, what is the place of Scripture? Now, we'll return to this idea again and again in this class. We'll talk about Scripture in many different times. But right now, let's just think about, as a kind of an introduction to the place of Scripture. If we're reluctant to give advice to people, well, then how do we use the Bible? Isn't the Bible the ultimate advice giver? Don't pastors use Scripture to tell people what to do? How does that work? Well, as I was saying right at the end of our last lecture, the primary purpose of the Bible is not actually telling us what to do. The main thing the Bible does is teach us how to think, as Christians, as holy people, as children of God, as people with the kingdom of God in view. The Bible isn't instruction in morality primarily. That would just lead us into an endless round of being unable to do what's right. That's what the Pharisees had. The Bible teaches us how to think in light of God's gifts to us and His presence in our lives. We want to help people orient their thinking to the gospel and all that it means in their thinking. We want to orient them to faith, to trusting God, to things like the death and the resurrection of Jesus, to being small instead of being proud. There are all these things that we are going to teach them in how they think that really doesn't have rules attached to them. You think of the Bible and how in the epistles, there's always a long section in every one of Paul's epistles that explains how Christians should think about things. And then from that, he goes to conclusions about how we ought to behave. So Scripture does much more to address our thinking than our doing. Remember Romans 12, 1 and 2 talks about us having our minds transformed, made over, made new, morphed into new kinds of ways. So it's our responsibility as people who love the Bible to teach our brothers and sisters how they internalize Scripture in such a way that their behavior and their anxieties or their pride or their struggles look differently, so they respond in different fashions. I've had students who come to this class and wanted to make a list of Bible passages for every problem they will ever face. So no matter what somebody comes in with, you can look in your book and go, oh, you need to read this passage. That'll never work. There are books like that, and there's a place where they're helpful to kind of get to a point quickly. But it isn't just looking up a verse. It's learning to think the way the Bible teaches us to think. And all of Scripture helps with that. You can read a passage that has nothing to say about your specific problem, and it will still help you to think well about the thing you're facing. I want you to think about something. When does someone help you with Bible counsel? When does it actually help you? People have given you biblical counsel. They've given you a verse of Scripture. They've said something that's true from the Bible to you. And you know that sometimes that didn't help you very much. When did it help you? What has to be true in someone for the Bible to help them? Because that's our goal. We want to get in so with Scripture so that it really changes people. Quite often, when people quote Scripture to someone, we do it rather on the surface. We're not really thinking too deeply about what they're facing. We haven't really entered into their life. We're kind of like a nurse at a school who says, oh, just take 2 aspirin and you'll feel better in the morning. But it isn't really true. Bible doesn't always help people because it doesn't enter the heart well. And some of that's our fault when we're too quick to just throw off Bible verses and they don't affect anyone. I think pastoral counseling has to consider how will Scripture, a particular passage, land on the heart of the person we're trying to help. If someone is stubbornly refusing to do God's will, then I think it's appropriate to say, look, my friend, this is what the Bible says. You can do it or you can disobey it, but this is what the Bible says. And you can be very direct because you can sense their issue is their stubborn heart and you're not going to persuade them to change. Now, actually, in counseling, those people don't usually come to you. So that's not a very common problem in counseling. People come because they want help. They just can't figure out how to get it. Sometimes people just don't know what Scripture says or how it applies. They know often the moral laws. They know they should be kind. They know they shouldn't do certain things. But they don't know how to get their heart to that place. They don't know how to think that that is good. And to just tell them you must do this doesn't change them. And even if they really bear down and try hard for a week or two, they can't keep up that goodness because it's not coming from their heart. And that's what we need to do as Christians to help them. Also, if there is pain in their lives or emotional turmoil, if they're frightened or worried, then sometimes we need to work our way into that place before we start laying out Scripture. If you give Scripture to people in pain too soon, it may not enter into their heart at all. It doesn't affect them. They hear you and they know you mean well, but it doesn't actually help them. Sometimes that listening process that we've talked about, where you listen carefully and get down to the issue beneath the issue, that has to happen before you can say wisely and lovingly, now let me remind you of something that Scripture says. I think this will really help you. When they know that you love them, that you've really listened, that you are a man or woman of integrity and of the Word, then they start to take that Word in. You don't give them everything you know. You don't tell them all that they might need to learn. You take it a little at a time. You need to be a good teacher so that and you're watching how they absorb, how they receive the things you're teaching. All that said, I want to be clear, we believe that the Bible is powerful. To use Scripture for someone is significant. We get this from Hebrews in chapter 4, where the Bible says, "For the Word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight." And that becomes clear in the Word. So we have confidence in Scripture. It isn't that we doubt it at all. We just need to be capable administrators of Scripture, wise physicians of the Word. Has your doctor ever given you the wrong medicine? Did he ever not listen to you long enough to find out that what really hurt wasn't what he gave you the medicine for? Pastors can do that too. We think we know what people need. We give them some verses and it doesn't help. I had students do an assignment once where they were talking about marriage. And the man was very domineering and very bossy and angry. And, of course, they all wanted to take him right to Ephesians 6 and tell about marriage. But when we talked about it, we thought, what if this man's afraid? What if he's proud? What if it isn't about marriage at all? What if it's about something else? We need to listen till we know what's really going on. We need to have confidence in Scripture, but we must use it properly. If we use the Scripture improperly, if we take it out of its context, if we use it in a way that God didn't really intend for it to be used, then we're like giving people bad medicine. It's good, but it's in the wrong place. If you take one medicine for another disease, it'll make you sick. You need good medicine. You need the truth that fits the situation, and that's our responsibility. But we know that Scripture is good for this. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all Scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, for rebuking, for correcting, and for training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Our goal is that people will do good work for the Lord Jesus, and Scripture is our great tool. Now, here's another hard thing for pastors to remember, teachers. Good teaching isn't always just telling. Good teaching isn't always just telling. We have all had teachers who told us things that were true and good, but we didn't learn much because we got bored. They weren't very good communicators. They weren't listening to what students were thinking or working on. We need to learn how to teach well, not only in a classroom or from the pulpit, but also when we sit with someone. So sometimes that's a matter of asking good questions, of provoking their thinking a little bit, of testing them here and there so that they see what is true and what isn't true. As much as we want to tell people things ourselves, we love doing that, we have to remember that real learning is best when students discover it for themselves. So we want to lead people to truth with questions. You want to ask them to look in their own Bible or give them yours and say, let's read this verse together. What does that mean? What do you think that's about? So that they start to understand it themselves, then they'll be much more likely to put that into practice in their lives.
We strive to serve the contemporary Christian community with a variety of Christian educational and evangelistic resources. To see TVS Seminary's database, please visit tvsseminary.com.
Remember, your secret serum, your secret medicine is grace. I have a little statement that rhymes in English, law reveals, grace heals. The Bible tells us that the law of God helps us to see our sin and our need. It reveals. We need it. But grace is what heals our hearts. Grace is what helps us find freedom and forgiveness and power. So the pastoral counselor works both of these things, law, but especially grace, because grace helps people. So when someone comes to me, I want to be a person who gives a signal of grace just in the way I sit, the way I meet them, the kindness I bring to them, that they feel grace in my presence. And then I want to set before them the grace that the Bible gives. So we say things, I'm so glad you came to talk to me. How pleased the Lord must be that you wanted to make this better. This is great. He's going to help you. I know He wants you to be a better believer. Ultimately, we counsel Christ. We will talk about all these things in Scripture, about our skills, but ultimately it's always about Jesus Christ. My pastor friend Dave said, we don't counsel a theory, we counsel a person. We counsel Christ, crucified, living, resurrected, reigning, empowering, and soon to return. This person, Christ, has made promises. The gospel of Jesus Christ offers us His pardon on the cross, His presence in our lives, His power through the Holy Spirit, His pleasure to sweeten every step of our obedience, and His people to surround us, encourage us, and assist us. Jesus Christ is a wonderful counselor. And He's building His church.